Welcome to this Stateless Code video, and in this video we're going to install the Windows Subsystem for Linux on a Windows machine. So I make a bunch of coding videos and I'm doing them using Ubuntu Linux. This is actually a dual boot machine, so I'm in Windows right now. It's the same machine I use the Linux boot of to record my various computer programming videos with Stateless Code here. And so a vast majority of people who could see my videos are Windows users rather than native Ubuntu or Linux or flavor type users. So what we're going to do here is show how you on Windows can set things up so that you can follow along with the videos that we do using Ubuntu and be able to do that in Windows without having to deal with installing another OS entirely on your system. This has gotten progressively easier over time. So it looks like it's down to, this is Windows Subsystem for Linux version 2, which is that they had a, I want to say 2020-ish, 2019, 2020. They had a kind of their initial release, and then a couple of years later came out with version 2. This doesn't even say that you need to enable virtualization in BIOS. So if you run into issues where it gives you an error and you do that, that's going to be different for every system. So when you boot up, it'll usually tell you to hit a key, either your escape or one of your function keys. You've only got like a second to do it, and that'll bring up BIOS, and then in the options, again, different for every system, you'll have an option to enable your kind of CPU virtualization, and then you can go on. So we're going to get on with installing this. So in order to do this, I need to launch PowerShell. See if I can get that. Windows PowerShell. I'm going to have to right click on it and click Run as Administrator. It's on my other window. And we're just going to run the command here, WSL --install. Didn't really even need to copy it. We'll pause the video and just let this happen. If anything gets prompted or anything, we'll... Oh, this is going pretty quick. Maybe I don't need to... An important thing to note here is it says here that Windows Subsystem has been installed and now it's installing Ubuntu. So if you want to install a different distribution than Ubuntu, then you would want to use a different set of commands than that WSL --install. And I'll show those in a moment once we're done here. Almost done with the distribution. Changes will not be effective until the system is rebooted. So I'm going to reboot my system and I'll come back and we'll actually set up the distribution. If you, that note with it installing Ubuntu by default, there is a linked page here on from the original that tells you the manual steps for install, so you can kind of go through all these different things and then step 6, install your Linux distribution of choice. You can also have multiple versions, multiple distributions of Linux installed on Windows Subsystem for Linux and kind of choose at runtime which one you want to use. So I'll reboot and be back in a couple minutes. All right, so as soon as I rebooted and logged back in, this Ubuntu window launched and said, Ubuntu's already installed, launching Ubuntu, installing this may take a few minutes. So we'll pause, let it take a few minutes. All right, so the installation is complete and it's prompting us to set a new user Unix username. First, just to make this a bit more readable, I'm going to go to properties here and set the font size, we'll say 36. That looks reasonable. So set this. It doesn't need to be the same as your Windows username. Both these usernames and passwords are distinct. So stateless code. Set a password. Retype it. Installation successful. And we are in Ubuntu 2204.3. So now we can do things. I'm going to make sure that we're up to date with packages and updates on the distribution itself, which are installing fairly quickly. While this is installing in the background, we'll take a look at the next thing we want to do, which is set up a Windows subsystem for Linux development environment. So we've done the install part. We've set up our username and password. We're doing the update and upgrade packages right now. We've done a little bit of, this article goes through different things that you can do for the terminal. Well, just other than setting the font a little bit larger, you can check out all these things, set whatever your preferences are. Talks about file storage preferences. If you're doing stuff in Linux, use the WSL file storage system for that Linux distribution. And now, let's see. We have the, I'm going to pin this. We'll exit briefly here. The next thing I'm going to do is install VS Code. I don't have it installed on this machine at all. So we're going to go into the Windows Store here and type Visual Studio Code, click install, probably get an admin prompt in a moment here. Let's pause and let this install. All right, it now shows as installed. I did not get an admin prompt for this, so we'll try launching VS Code. This is the get started here. We're going to now, you can use VS Code. This is installed in Windows, but we can use the remote developer extensions and install those. Open with VS Code, install. And it looks like they're all installed. Now relaunch VS Code, and in this lower left hand here, I'm going to choose connect to WSL. The first time you do it, it downloads the server on the Linux side so that it can communicate with VS Code. So we're going to open a terminal now, and we see that this terminal is a terminal on our VS Code remote. So the next thing we're going to do is install Git. Git is already installed and the newest version. So now I'm going to clone a repo. We'll use the Stateless Code Nerd Dice Ruby Gem repo. On GitHub. We will just git clone create a subdirectory here so it's not directly in the home directory. Now we'll git clone the repo. And then should be able to open folder repos nerd dice. Yes, I trust the authors. I am the authors. And we can see that our code is there and present. And then you can go in and do all of your VS Code preferences and stuff like that for how you want to run it. It has separate settings for your remote WSL kind of user workspace. So you can set those independently from if you're doing development also with VS Code on native Windows, you can differentiate between the two if you want to say use Unix line endings and Linux and Windows line endings and Windows or whatever, that you could kind of set those things. Although, why would you ever want to use Windows line endings? But that's another topic for another day. So I'll put all of these resources in the show notes for this video. If you run into any issues, the manual installation steps will probably help you kind of catch things in the middle. If for whatever reason it's not working, I would check the that you're using the you're above the minimum here, so it has to be Windows 10 version 2004 build 19.041 or later, or Windows 11 in order to be able to do this. And once you get that done, there isn't, I use Windows 11 at work during my day job, not really that different from a Windows subsystem for a Linux standpoint between 10 and 11 on this. You can try around and play with some other repos, and then you can code along with Stateless Code. Ruby on Rails 7 is out. Code along on a guided journey through the Rails 7 Getting Started Guide and beyond with test-driven development. There has never been a better time to learn Ruby on Rails. Hit the ground running with the newest version. Go to statelesscode.com/getting-started-with-rails-7 to level up. Thanks for watching this Stateless Code video. Be sure to like, comment, subscribe, and spread the word. Check out our growing library of videos on our social media channels. Follow us at Stateless Code, and taxation is theft.